Welcome everyone to Nikkei Crypto Asset Forum. The title of this session is Valuing Crypto Assets. I am super excited to have all of you here. We have two amazing gentlemen who are going to share their views towards the crypto assets with us today. They are the most famous figures and the market opinion leaders, not only in the crypto world, but also in the evolving global financial industry. I think most of you already know, but let me briefly introduce them. First, Mr. Dan Moorhead, CEO and co-CIO of Pantera Capital, the first investment firm in the US to launch digital currency, early stage token, and blockchain-enabled venture fund. He used to serve as the head of macro trading and CFO at the leading hedge fund Tiger Management. Dan, welcome and very nice to have you today.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
Thank you. And then Mr. Mike Novogratz, founder and CEO of Galaxy Digital, one of the largest diversified financial services firm dedicated to the digital assets. Mike was also the hedge fund manager at the world famous investment firm Fortress Investment Group before establishing Galaxy Digital. Mike, thank you very much for joining us today.
And most importantly, I was used to work for Oki Matsumoto.
yes, of course, our chairman. By the way, my name is Nana Otsuki. I am chief analyst at Monex Securities and head of Monex Crypto Asset Research. It's a great honor being an MC for this session. Before starting QA, how can I call you guys? Just Mike and Dan, is it okay?
That's fine.
Thank you. And please just call me Nana. Okay, let us have the Q&A session. Let's dive in. First question is about the market. Last week, the crypto market dropped all of a sudden, but until then, I understand the market has been growing steadily since the halving of Bitcoin last May. What do you think would be the main reasons for this strong movement of crypto assets? Dan, what do you think?
Yeah,
do you
so
have
Mike,
any idea?
Yeah, Mike and I have been invested in this space for 8 years, and the technology keeps growing, and you know, all the underlying fundamentals have been the same and strong. The two big things that have happened this year are the halving and the monetary stimulus that has been a result of the pandemic. The halving historically has had a massive impact on the price. Mm-hmm. We've used past halvings to forecast what this would do. And each halving is obviously smaller than the previous one. The first one made the markets go up 90 times, and then the markets went up about 30 times in the second halving. And we estimated the market would go up about 10x through this halving. And last April, we forecast that Bitcoin would hit $62,968 last week, and it did. So it's just a proportion of all the previous halvings.
I see. Can I just share one picture chart to show what you said, Dan? That's about the price movement after halving of Bitcoin. As you mentioned, it had grown immediately after the halving, which is the first one is, as you mentioned, very sharp increase after the halving. And the last one was blue line. And then this time is red color. So if we assume that the Bitcoin price is going to trace the same pattern as last time, as you mentioned, the potential of growth could be very large. That's what you mentioned, Dan.
Yeah, so okay, if you use mm-hmm. those ratios, it would put it at 115,000 in August of this year.
Yeah, this one, around this time. Yeah, mm-hmm. Just for the audience, the vertical line is localism of Bitcoin dollar price. So yeah, this one would show about 120,000. Yeah, thank you very much. And then,
Can I add one thing? Because I think Dan was right. The macroeconomic environment is amazing, mm-hmm. right? With so much money printing happening all over the world. Mm-hmm. The other piece to this is that we've seen post-COVID an amazing acceleration of institutional adoption.
Mm-hmm.
Like, crypto globally used to be very much retail driven. Mm-hmm. And it, within this last 12 months, we've seen the biggest names in the hedge fund industry, like Stan mm-hmm. Druckenmiller and Paul Tudor Jones, mm-hmm. Publicly state they're buying crypto. And now almost every hedge fund we talk to is taking some position in Bitcoin and looking at the whole ecosystem more. But it's not just hedge funds. Even in the United States, four of the five of the biggest insurance companies in the United States have bought Bitcoin, and they bought Bitcoin for their general account, which is a really important thing to understand. That's like the most precious money in an insurance company. And it's regulated by the Federal Reserve, and it's regulated by the insurance commissioner. Mm-hmm. And they're buying it as a long duration asset. In essence, replacing bonds with Bitcoin. And so you've got hedge funds, insurance companies, now real money managers, money managers like Guggenheim, BlackRock looking, are starting to buy into crypto. And you've got high net worth, the family offices and the wealthy people. And so you almost have every asset class on the institutional side just starting in crypto. And they're all starting in Bitcoin. They start in Bitcoin, then they move to Ethereum, and then they move to other things. Yeah. But so it's really a Bitcoin first institutional led movement, but it's unbelievably strong. We set up to cover institutions, and I've literally hired 75 people in 5 months.
Just
try to, you know, cover them on asset management, sales and trading, and build out our infrastructure.
Yeah, interesting. When it comes to the institutional investors, I saw, Mike, that you answered to the media interviews the other day saying that the crypto assets are becoming increasingly important for the hedging instrument for the global inflation to come. Do you think it could be another reason to hedge the inflation to come?
Certainly, right? The macro backdrop with record deficits in the United States, record deficits in Europe, central banks printing money faster than they ever have, pushes all hard assets up. And Bitcoin is a hard asset. There are only 21 million Bitcoin that will ever be mined. Mm-hmm. I think 18.8 million have been mined. So there are very few Bitcoin left to be mined. And so this idea that I need to store my wealth in something, you know, real estate is going up, art is going up, collectibles are going up, but in something big and uniform, Bitcoin has really replaced gold as the place people want to preserve wealth because the dollar is depreciating every year. And it's, and interestingly, all fiat, the dollar, the yen, the euro, if you put it all together and make one index, it's depreciating versus assets every year.
That's true. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, let me move on to the next question, which is, as we discussed, cryptocurrency has been really strong. However, let us discuss a bit about the recent drop of the market. Some media reported that it is to do with the listing of Coinbase, as well as some regulatory movement. But what do you think are the reasons, in your view, of this drop? And do you think that the market would recover in the near future? Dan, what do you think, Dan?
Yeah, I'd like to just put it in perspective. The markets average a 213% compound annual growth rate. So they're going to go down 15% from time to time. Bitcoin has had seven consecutive positive months, which, you know, very few assets ever do that. So it's going to have these short-term swings. I think, you know, within weeks, it'll begin hitting new highs and keep growing. So all these are just opportunities to address the market for people to get more positions on, but it doesn't change my view that the markets will be very strong.
Okay, so it's just a short-term adjustment of the speed. Thank you. What about you, Mike?
If you think about what Coinbase means, in a lot of ways, it's the first time there's a large equity that is come to the market, right? A $65 billion market cap. And so it's the first time a lot of equity investors in the US get to participate in a company that really is a crypto ecosystem company. And so I think it was one of the more, I remember in 1995, Netscape was one of the original internet companies. They had, you had the Netscape moment that really ushered in the era of the internet. And in some ways, what the Coinbase IPO said loud and clear is crypto is an asset class. And if you're not long, you're short. And so there are a lot of people sitting out there that said, oh, I don't believe it. I don't know. I'm worried. Now they're seeing all their peers in insurance companies and hedge funds buying Bitcoin, buying Ethereum, now buying Coinbase. And so there's a mindset shift that's happening around institutions to say, how do I get my exposure? And I think you're only going to see more and more institutions coming in. And so even though there was a lot of excitement, and so maybe prices, like Dan say, go up and down 15%, the far more important story is that we now have the first real bellwether stock. I'm hoping Galaxy is the second bellwether stock. We traded the Toronto Exchange. We've made it public through our filing that we plan on moving to the US in the second half of the year. But for an industry to have two, three, four, five bellwethers, it pulls everyone in. And I think you're seeing that happen right now.
Right. So in that sense, it is just short-term break, but the fundamental shift to the crypto asset wouldn't
change. It's a positive fundamental shift.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And change a bit. Let us change a bit the subject a bit. It's about both of you. I presume that many audiences are so curious about the reason why both of you had decided to shift to the crypto world. We understand that both of you have had great success in your former career as a traditional financial sector already. But what was the aha moment that made you jump over to the crypto asset market? So let us start with Mike.
It's funny because Dan and I have a long history. We went to the same university. At one point, we worked at Goldman Sachs. At one point, we were neighbors in Tokyo. And at one point, we both ran macro hedge funds. And we got into crypto roughly the same time. Matter of fact, Dan bought a lot of our early coins. And you know, he can tell his aha moment. I bought it originally. One of them was Dan had done a whole lot of homework and he called me up and he said, wow, this is a lot more important than we thought. It's going to change the world. That was in 2013. And so I bought a little more than I was going to buy. I had my own aha moment. You know, I was already long and I had told my partners we would own crypto, but we wouldn't talk about it publicly. And I got talking about it publicly. And next thing you know, I was on the cover of the newspaper and I start getting asked to speak at all these places. And so it made me study a lot more because I didn't want to look stupid in front of everybody. And I remember this sentence that made it clear to me that the Satoshi white paper, when she wrote that white paper, I could boil it down to one sentence. That this was the first digital signature we couldn't counterfeit. That was the first digital, you know, asset that couldn't be duplicated and counterfeited. And as I thought about that more and more, I thought how unique that was. And that I went from thinking, this is kind of cool, to understanding why it had a chance. Now, back then, it just had a chance. There was no guarantee. It was a lot riskier to invest back then than it is today. there was no guarantee that it would have been the social phenomenon it was, right? Bitcoin is probably the best brand that has been created in the last 100 years.
Really?
Think about what I just said. It's probably the best brand that has been created. Mm, 100
years. That's true.
The value of Bitcoin comes from the fact that Dan and I and you and Oki say it has value. It's not just from the technology, right? We can take technology and call it Matsumoto coin, and maybe it wouldn't be so valuable, right? It's the social construct that we all believe it has value. And so it's the brand, and it's all the people that have worked on building the brand. And so that was a real aha moment, understanding what the real core essence of why it could work is.
Thank you. What about you, Dan?
Yeah, it's fun because Mike and I do have kind of the same aha moment because we were in the same room talking about it. And I guess for me, you know, my brother had turned me on to Bitcoin in 2011, and I read a few things about it and I thought, yeah, that'd be great. I hope it really happens, but I didn't actually do anything. And then Mike and his partner called and invited me in for a coffee to talk about it. Mm-hmm. And I vividly remember this, that the coffee went on for hours and hours and we just kept getting more excited. And then finally they said, hey, you could just have, you know, an office in our building here to work on this some more. And I just couldn't do anything else for the next 3 or 4 months. And I had a career of looking at very asymmetric trades, things where you could lose some money, but you know, you had many times that as upside. And when I thought about this, I think Bitcoin is it's like a call option on the future payment rail of the world, right? Such an incredibly valuable thing. And at the time it was priced incredibly low. I think it's still very low relative to the markets it's going to disrupt. It's going to disrupt gold, which is 10 trillion, you know, all online payments, money transfer, cross-border money transfer, even money. Money's a $100 trillion market. So all these massive markets are going to be disrupted. And so decided that, you know, this was the biggest trade, I think, of a generation. I think it's, some people say it's like the internet, but in my mind, it is the final piece of the protocol puzzle that is the internet. So the next 10 or 20 years are going to be an amazing time to be an investor in this space.
Interesting. So you guys have very good insight into this asset class. And also you have good friends to discuss about this. Yeah, interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, we've been on this crazy journey together.
Yeah, I understand that it is not that easy for ordinary people to just throw away, to some extent, throw away the reputation in the traditional world and jump into really new, unknown, uncertain world. It won't be that easy. But yeah, it's really interesting.
And quite frankly, Dan and I maybe are the two oldest guys in all of the crypto community. It's a revolution of young people in lots of ways.
That's true.
It's a revolution of young people that wanted to change the way society was put together. And so Gen Z and millennials, and a lot of the companies we invest in, you know, we're talking to 25-year-olds. Dan had a 17-year-old employee at one point that became my friend.
Really?
So one of the benefits of that is if you're young. You know, you're always learning. You're dealing with young people, but so I can look around all the time that we're the two oldest guys. But that was actually, for me, one of the excitements was to be able to work with all these young, bright people.
That's true. Yeah, interesting. Yeah, as you mentioned, younger generation in the States are really leading the global market of this area. But unfortunately, as you are aware, Japan is a bit different. There are still skeptical views towards the crypto market, although Monex and Coincheck ourselves have been really seriously publicizing the growth potential of this market. What do you think would be the main reasons the U.S. crypto market has successfully grown, apart from, as you mentioned, younger generation power? Do you have any advices that we could do to change such Japanese skepticism going forward?
You know, listen, the U.S. has done a very good job of fostering a culture of innovation.
Mm.
I think I once read in one of Dan's letters that 60% or 70% of the companies he invested in were within 5 miles of his office in Silicon Valley. And so that area was where lots of the tech companies were being built, is where a lot of crypto innovation happened. It happened elsewhere as well. You see a pocket of it in Berlin, Germany, and in some in Israel, and even now in Korea. You know, there's a lot, some stuff going on in Korea. But Japan, other than having companies, hasn't fostered that sense of creativity in creating the companies. And so it's had plenty of investors, right? Mm-hmm. Because just like you had foreign exchange investors, Japan has lots of crypto investors. But what really has created the excitement are people creating new protocols, trying to understand how they can change the way we take taxis, how that we can change the way we vote, how we have payments.
Right.
So it's that idea of using blockchain and using crypto to actually rebuild the financial and consumer infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the excitement comes from. That's where the revolution happens. And that's what the excitement And I think Japan hasn't had that fostering of that culture.
Do you think it is to do with the culture, as you mentioned, or a structural problem of the society or the government?
You know, I haven't spent enough time in Japan recently. I did live there a long time ago, and I love the country. I have an apartment there. It's one of my favorite places in the world. but it has a rigid culture. It doesn't have an entrepreneurial culture, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this literally needs, the society needs to feed, in essence, that culture of entrepreneurism.
I see. Right. Thank you. What about you, Dan? What's the difference in Japan and the States?
Like Mike, it's been a long time since I've worked in Japan, but in the United States, I know that the government was actually quite early in being clear about regulations. They weren't promoting Bitcoin, but they certainly weren't hampering it. So in 2013, so 8 years ago now, the IRS ruled on the taxation of Bitcoin as property, which is the best taxation it could have. The Treasury Department ruled that it was money transmission. In 2017, the Commodities Futures Trading Commission ruled that it was a commodity. And so you could have futures on Bitcoin and now Ethereum. And then last year, the banking regulator, the OCC, ruled that any nationally chartered bank could custody cryptocurrency assets. Those have been very, very helpful. Like Mike said, there's a lot of very famous investors now that are just getting engaged in Bitcoin. And I'm sure a lot of it has to do with the fact they can now custody their Bitcoin at the parent company, the New York Stock Exchange, or at Fidelity, or now you know, Coinbase is a big, huge, valuable company. That makes it so much easier to make that decision to commit some capital when the government has made a framework that allows banks and other very careful fiduciaries to be able to trade in crypto.
That's true. Yeah, thank you. So both government, the OS system as a whole, and innovation. Okay. Yeah, talking about the innovation, there are so many new products or innovation nowadays in this crypto market, as you are aware. And what kind of innovation or products are you keeping your eyes on nowadays? DeFi, NFT, and so on. What do you think, Dan?
So I think the biggest disruptor in the next 10 years will probably be DeFi.
DeFi, okay.
You know, in lots of ways, Bitcoin got everyone scared in the banking system, but Bitcoin is a digital store of wealth, a digital asset. And so if I was a bank, I think, geez, what a missed opportunity in buying it myself, in trading it, and letting my customers buy it and asset managing it. But it wasn't a direct what I did. DeFi is peer-to-peer. It's using a blockchain to put it under financial services. And a blockchain is basically code. And so it's putting out lots of people in between and creating a peer-to-peer system where Dan and I can trade equities or currencies or interest rates or insurance. And so in lots of ways, it's creating driverless banks and driverless insurance companies and driverless derivative markets.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of regulatory issues around it,
yeah.
But the smartest people I know in the space right now, my smartest people are all working on trying to understand how to solve some of those.
Really?
And most of those are around knowing your customer, mm-hmm. right, and anti-money laundering, and then tax. And I firmly believe in the next 1 to 3 years, those issues get solved and DeFi is going to explode.
I see.
You know, that's where we're spending a lot of time making bets.
Okay.
They're not big crypto bets. They're more venture bets because mm-hmm. they start with small programs. But now there's what we call like the big five or the big six, the DeFi blue chips. And it's kind of comical because they've only been around for 6 months. But they've taken maybe a year, but they've taken hold. They've got big usage and it's really worthwhile for anyone who works at a financial institution to pay attention. These are names like Sushi and Compound and Aave mm-hmm. and Uniswap. Very important protocols, I think, for the future.
Interesting. So in that perspective, do you think that the regulatory bodies should create a universal global type of protocol of regulation going forward, not only each individual country? Do you think we need?
I would personally love that. I don't think it would happen, but it would make life so much easier.
That's true.
And it would almost be too smart for them to do.
Okay. What about you, Dan? What kind of innovation or product?
No, I agree with Mike. Decentralized mm-hmm. finance is a huge, huge thing. And mm-hmm. when you put it in perspective, the internet totally disrupted all the other things in our life. You know, how we do commerce, how we communicate. But it didn't really change banking. It didn't change credit cards. It didn't change big exchanges. They're all the same. And kind of the irony of Coinbase being this huge seminal moment for our industry is it's massively centralized. It's, you know, one equity owned company that is very centralized. These decentralized exchanges that Mike just mentioned, like Oneinch and Sushi and Uniswap, they're sometimes doing more volume than Coinbase. So that is the future. And it just is a great example of how quickly disruption happens.
Mm-hmm.
Coinbase has only been around for 7 years. It's totally disrupted one asset class. And now a decentralized version of exchanges is starting to disrupt Coinbase.
Mm.
So in the future, there will be a parallel economy where decentralized finance is allowing two people to do commerce with code as the intermediary rather than an expensive bank or some kind of escrow trust institution, whether it's borrowing and lending or exchanges where an asset's being sold and money's being paid. So to my mind, you know, DeFi is kind of the next 10 years.
Interesting.
If you remember, the spirit of this revolution was to cut out the rent taker, right? Was the young people feeling fed up with the center, with authority, with the rent taker, and to cut it out. And so I constantly tell the people at my company, we are a bridge to a new version of our company, and we will probably have to bite our arm off to survive, right? Like, because some of our business, we're investing in a lot of these new businesses, but some of our businesses are more traditional. And I was like, those won't be here in 4 or 5 years. You know, our company has to continue to change or it's going to get eaten alive by, and the pace of innovation is amazing. And some of the best entrepreneurs I've ever seen work in this space, you know, Sam Bankman-Fried and with what he's doing in the exchange world is just shocking, the risks they take and how fast they innovate.
Interesting.
It makes it a very fun place to work.
That's true. If that's the case, do you think that the traditional banking industry would disappear or diminish significantly?
Yes.
Diminish.
They're not going to disappear. And, you know, they're going to fight back like crazy.
That's true.
Right? They're going to find a threat. And so a lot of the regulatory pushback is going to be because the banks are going to be fighting.
But also, you know, it's an opportunity. They can provide new products and services to their customers that are better, faster, and cheaper using blockchain.
That's true. Yeah.
And I think Visa is
struggling.
Visa is a good example. It's been around for 70 years. One of my first thoughts when Mike and I were talking about what trades should we do, we should get long Bitcoin and short Visa. That would have been terrible. Visa's been going up, a huge amount since then. And, but they're engaged. They're investing in a lot of really interesting projects in the blockchain space because they know the world is changing, but they're going to try and provide better services to their customers using blockchain. So it's certainly not going to get rid of the legacy financial firms, but they're going to change.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's a great point. And I think there are two different groups that are going to fight on this thing. One is the tech companies. They're all getting engaged, right? Facebook's coming, PayPal's coming, Apple at one point with the Apple wallet, right? One thing that's clear is today people have bank accounts. In the future, they're going to have wallets. And the wallet is different than the bank account. On my phone right now, I might have 40 different passwords I've got to put in to send money, right? The wallet's going to be where you keep all your things. It's going to be one secure wallet. And so the world is going to change. And who wins that wallet war? Is it going to be the bank? Is going to be something to keep your eye on.
Interesting. So based on the future picture that you guys draw, what do you think would be the cryptocurrency market going forward? At this moment, as you are aware, $2 trillion reached about one to two weeks ago, but it's still just 2% of global stock market and just 20% of gold. What do you think the crypto market would grow?
Think of it a different way. It's 0.5% of global wealth. 0.5% of global wealth. If you're looking at the trends in the next 2 to 3 years, if it's not 2, 3, 4% of global wealth, something has changed. And so that's a gigantic shift.
That's true.
The way I like to think about it is this. Let's just say we're playing a tug of war, when one half of the team's on one side of the rope, or a football game or a rugby match. Apple, one of the best companies in the world, American, it's about a $2 trillion company. It's about the same as all of crypto. If I took all the engineers of Apple, all the salespeople, all their employees, and put them on one side of that rope or one side of that football field. And on the other side, I took all of the smart engineers in the blockchain space at every one of the protocols, all the salesmen and the traders and the user group. And I had a war. It would be applesauce. Like, there is so much intellectual capital pouring into building this new architecture, from Vitalik Buterin, and to Satoshi, wherever she is, all of this genius brain power is operating in a decentralized way with a similar goal. And I just don't think you want to short that. I think you want to ride with that tide.
That's true. Interesting. What about you, Dan? And by the way, Mike, you mentioned that hypothetically, if people, wealth people have 2 to 4% of their financial assets to this cryptocurrency, but what would you recommend both Mike and Dan? What percentage of financial assets do you think they should allocate your money and their money to crypto assets?
A lot depends on how much excess savings people have are in their wealth journey.
That's true.
If you're really young, it would probably be a lot. A little older, less. I used to say 1 to 2%, and now I say 3 to 5% for new people.
Oh, yeah.
Ann and I probably have 80%. I'm close to 80% of my net worth is in crypto. Now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Next
question.
What about you, Dan?
Yeah, one of the most important points is not zero is the first thing.
Yes,
having zero is really the riskiest thing. Whether it's 1% or 3%, I think, like Mike says, it totally depends on where you are in life. But we've seen asset classes be created, commodities in the 80s, emerging markets, and they always end up with 6, 7, 8% weighting in everybody's portfolio. I think blockchain will easily be one of those numbers within the next few years. So, high single digits is a good place to start. And the question of where it's going, we just put in our investor letter a couple of days ago that Bitcoin, the number of people using Bitcoin and also the price has gone up 10x every 2 years for 10 years. The pace might slow down now that we're getting big. You know, we're starting to get into pretty big numbers, but I think the number of people using Bitcoin will go up 10x. There's about 100 million people using it now. I could easily see 1 billion people using it in a few years. All you need to use Bitcoin is a smartphone, and 3.5 billion people have one of those. So I could easily see that happening. And the price going up 10x over the next few years, I think could really happen. And again, as a trader, you're looking for trades like that. It might go to zero, but it might go up 10x. And I think it's kind of like a 50-50 chance that it goes up 10x. So if you multiply those together, that's a very attractive trade.
And I would actually, the only thing I disagree with, I don't think it can go to zero again. It used to have the chance to go to zero, but now there is such an embedded community of believers in this that aren't going to help. There are, you know, these ecosystems are belief systems in lots of ways. And there are people, and you know, it's funny because you go on Twitter and each of the coins have their own belief system and their own, it's almost like European soccer teams. If I say something bad about the Litecoin community, I start getting all these terrible, you know, emails. Or if you criticize the XRP army, you almost get death threats. You know? But there is a big enough belief system around Bitcoin specifically that I think we're not going to be back at zero. But it could not, you know, it could certainly sell off. There could be regulation that could get people scared. That's less and less likely. Because as Bitcoin gets more adoption, it gets more institutional support. It gets more wealthy people understanding it. It's their political support. And so now it would be very politically unfriendly for someone to say, hey, let's ban Bitcoin, right?
Okay.
A lot of single issue voters would say, hey, let's ban that politician.
I see. Yeah, that's true. I think it is almost a time. Okay, so maybe I'd like you to have some final comment. Let me see. Do you have any advice to the Japanese audience, investors, media, or other related parties who are listening to this? Do you have any expectations to the Japanese market or investors or Manex and Coincheck ourselves to further grow the market? Do you have any advice, comments, please? Mike, what do you think?
Let me go first. Well, first I want to say thank you for having me. Like I said, I love Japan, and I can't wait till COVID's over so I can go back and go to my favorite place, Shima Steakhouse. I think what Dan hit on earlier, for the regulators to give clear rules is the most important. And I think there should be a regulatory sandbox around new innovation. You know, the Japanese has a culture, has a group of people that love to speculate, right? They used to see it in the foreign, both Dan and I were in the foreign exchange markets when we were in Japan, and there was lots of speculating in foreign exchange. And so there's already the psychology of participating in crypto. And then it's for people to do their homework, to learn what Bitcoin is, to learn what Ethereum is, and then take a small piece and look at some of the other coins. What is DeFi? You know, because it's piecing all that puzzle together, you really start understanding it. And then you also understand how to stay away from the stuff that doesn't make a lot of sense, that might go up and it'll go straight back down. And so if you have time to do that work, if not, to find very reputable places and just make your bet in Bitcoin or Ethereum.
That's great. What about to us, Manex and Coincheck? Do you have any advice or expectation, if any?
Well, listen, I would tell you that Dan and I have probably given more Bitcoin and crypto speeches, interviews, talks, any two people on the planet. I would like to compare how many, you know. And in it, this is a game about education. And, you know, this seminar is education, and it is, you don't get paid for it right away. I used to think I should have like a tip jar and say, oh, please, for all the talks. It's educating people on how the system works.
Mm-hmm.
It is a belief system. Yeah. And it takes a lot. And you finally cross over a hill, and then the ball starts rolling downhill.
That's true.
It's getting some of the influential investors in Tokyo, the influential companies on the institutional basis to go in. When Paul Tudor Jones in America, who's one of the most famous hedge fund managers, when he invested, he also wrote a letter about why he invested.
Really?
Every hedge fund manager read that. And Bennett said, he might be right, he might be wrong, but if I invest and I'm wrong, no one's going to call me stupid. Right? He took a lot of the career risk away by being courageous and bold. And so the more people that will publicly talk about why they invested, the easier it is to get other people to invest.
Oh, interesting. What about you, Dan?
Yeah, so my main advice is to actually just carve out some time to those that don't yet have exposure. Carve out some time and read about it. And I found that any person that actually spends a bit of time reading about it, they buy, they really do. And I knew about Bitcoin for 18 months before I did anything, but Mike and his partner got me to made me sit there and read about it for a couple of days. And it blew my mind how important it's gonna be. And I've very, very rarely ever come across someone that's done all the work and just says, I don't think I'm gonna invest. It's a bad idea. There's a ton of people that haven't invested yet just because they have their own day jobs and they don't have to focus on blockchain. But if you actually do spend the time to read about it, most people do invest. And so doing that now versus 5 years from now is probably gonna be a good trade.
Yeah, thank you.
That's a great point.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Dan Moorhead of Pantera Capital and Mr. Mike Novogratz of Galaxy Digital. Thank you again very much for your great discussion. And thank you very much for all the audience to participate to this session. I hope to connect with you in the near future again. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.